Get up and face the truth. Life is up to you. Just go forward. Find your feet, my friend. Time heals everything. Just go forward. As the sun goes down, we carry on regardless. Arms are open wide. To cry, no feet forward. Stand up proud, shout out loud.
Also a great honor for me to be able to present the message today. For 11 years, I've had the awesome privilege of being your camp director, and it continues to be a crazy and enjoyable ride. You know, this year, I already know is going to be a great summer, where a lot of children and adults are going to be able to come to the camp, get away from the distractions of the world, and grow closer to God. Maybe to connect with God for the first time, maybe just to reconnect. Maybe they'll come and they'll make decisions to follow God or follow Christ and give their life to Christ for the rest of their lives. Decisions will be made this summer that will impact lives for eternity. And we're able to do that because of this church and churches like yours that sacrificially give to make that happen. So thank you. Thank you for all that you do to make Wolverine what it is today. You know, at camp we have a lot of fun. We have a lot of fun, but it is also a place where people get to know God and it furthers the kingdom. And this year's theme, this year's theme, I believe is going to be a powerful one. Your children will be challenged to get up every morning and decide, what are they going to follow? What are they going to do? Are they going to mark out the road that God has set before them? Or are they going to take the path that the world tells them to take? You know, that path that God has led for them, yes, it's going to be a harder one, but it's one that is well worth the ride. You know, at camp, people get impact lives for eternity. They get influenced at camp. So I started thinking about some of the people that have influenced my life. Beside my parents, who has influenced me to help me become the person I am today? And one of the people, and I've probably talked about them before, is Aunt Nancy and Uncle Les. All right, they're no relatives of mine, but that's what they called themselves. They were traveling children evangelists or traveling children ministers. And they were at every family camp I went to, every church camp I went to growing up, they were there. And they were at nearly every VBS that I ever went to. And they had just this ability to bring the Bible stories to life. You know, with Aunt Nancy's flannel board to bring up those, you know, and those stories. And then Uncle Les's just mastery of puppetry. We were able to just really enjoy, and the stories came to life. But one thing that was also about them is they always had time for the kids that they served. And they always remembered us. My senior year in high school, years after ever being in any type of program of theirs, I was in an open house, a graduation open house. And they came over and they sat next to me. And they didn't just recognize me. They remembered me. They called me by name. And they sat down and they talked to me. Wanted to know what my plans were for the future, what I was going to do next. And I still remember Uncle Les's face, the way it lit up when I said I was going to a Christian college. And they both looked at me and they told me how proud of them, or how proud of them they were, how proud they were of me. That is something that I'll never forget, the impact that they had on me. And that's one of the reasons why I'm in ministry today. There's other people that have influenced our lives. A lot of times, your coaches influence your life, right? Not always spiritually, but I remember my first coaches. In fourth grade, in Davison, in fourth grade, you can sign up for tackle football. I don't know if that's the same thing here. So in fourth grade, I signed up for tackle football, and I got put on the team, the Oilers. All right, so I was an Oiler. And my dad got pretty excited when he looked to see who our coaches was. He's like, "Your coaches are the Elizondo brothers?" And I was, "Okay, sure." And he's like, "You don't understand. I played high school ball with football with them. They were two of the best teammates." And I mean, for a fourth grader, he really built it up. Like, to the point where the first time I set foot on that field, a.k.a. the playground, that first time I sat there, I thought I was in, like, the presence of greatness. And then it even got more excited because they looked up and they saw who my dad was, and they said, "Your dad is Lynn Oglin? He was our best defensive player." And oh my goodness, now I'm just, my head's like this big. I'm so excited. I'm surrounded by greatness, right? All right, and then just to make a long story short, what happened was about a year later, my dad became the defensive coach, and with the Elizondo brothers and my dad, this team became unstoppable. Not only had we, going into our last game, we were going into our last game undefeated, not a team had even scored on us. That's how good we were going in the last game. Well, what ended up happening is some of the sixth graders that were going to be moving up to, you know, the school league thought that they deserved to play something different. So the center now wanted to play quarterback, and the quarterback now wanted to play running back, and some of these sixth graders thought that they deserved to play different because it was their last game. Well, of course, the coaches didn't like that idea too well and stuck with the plan. And again, to make a long story short, because of a few players that didn't want to do their job and was upset and wanted to punish the rest of the team, not only did we get scored on, but at the last minute, we lost the game. See, those are just great examples of how you can remember and you can be influenced by people in so many ways, but it's also a great example about how a few selfish people can really mess it up for the whole team or for the whole group, can't they? And that's kind of what we're going to talk about today, what kind of Paul talks about, I should say, in 1 Corinthians 9. We're going to start in verse 24 if you want to start looking that up. Now, if you read earlier in the chapter, we see that Paul is dealing with some problems with people questioning his authorship, you know, of being an apostle. All right? They're like kind of questioning him. They're trying to tarnish his character. So you read in before that, you read him establishing his authority as an apostle and making it very clear that although he was born a free man or a Roman citizen, meaning he was a slave to no king, he has made himself a slave so that he may win some people. All right, so what he's saying is, I'm willing to do whatever it takes to show this world the saving knowledge of Christ and salvation found only in his death on a cross. So keeping that in mind, let's read in verse 24. 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24, it says, "Do you not know that in a race all runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize." All right, so Paul is using imagery here that back then everybody would know exactly what he's talking about. See, back then there was this huge race that happened like every other year. It was second in popularity only to the Olympics. Okay, this was a big deal. This was a big race. And so everybody knew kind of what he was talking about. And so he's saying, he wanted you them all to know that we want you to just run hard in that race. We don't want you just to participate. You shouldn't just want to be a participation and be a participant in the race. He's like, run like you want to win. Don't be content with just a participation ribbon. Run with passion, with a sense of urgency, knowing that there are forces out there that do not want you to win. There are forces out there that don't want you to finish the race strong. Run with passion. Now, would you say that there's some, this culture in a way is getting to the point where everybody should get a trophy? Everybody that participates wins? Have you seen that kind of mentality? And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with encouraging people. That's not what I'm saying. But what happens when we get to the point where everybody wins or everybody gets a participation ribbon, we have a tendency to not want to struggle or to fight as hard as we might. We get comfortable sitting back and just participating. Does that make sense? And see, we need to make sure that in our Christian walk, we're not content with just sitting back and participating. What Paul is saying here is run with passion, run with everything, run to win. Have you ever heard somebody say, the way I am is good enough? The way I am is good enough. Don't try to change me. The way I am is good enough. And somebody along the line comes and says, yes, you know, you are good. But if you focused a little bit more, if you gave God some more of your attention, you could be so much more. What tends to happen to that person that encourages the other person? They usually get met with anger, don't they? Don't you judge me. I'm fine the way I am. God didn't make a mistake. Have you ever heard something like that? See, what people don't realize is true, God does not make a mistake, but we do. We mess up. We miss the point. We fall short. And what we need to remember is that God loves us too much to let us stay where we are. He loves us too much to let us just lean back and just participate in the race. All right. Is there anybody here that is willing to admit that they love the Rocky movies? All right. Quite a few hands. All right. Thank you. So I'm not the only one. All right. Church a couple weeks ago, it was like crickets. All right. All right. I really enjoy the Rocky movies. All right. But another thing that I really enjoy about the Rocky movies is the soundtrack. Who's willing to admit that the soundtrack is some of the best soundtrack ever when it comes to a movie? All right, The Eye of the Tiger, are you kidding me? You know, just that beginning, that dun, 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 dun. Isn't that just enough to make you want to put on an old pair of sweatsuit, drink a bunch of raw eggs, and just start going running? No. True, it does me, but true, I wouldn't get very far. But I still want to do it, all right? You know, it motivates you. And ladies, I'm going to tell a little secret, and some of your husbands might get mad. If you're tired of your husband not moving around, you want him to get up and get motivated, just put this on. Just put that song on, okay? 9 times out of 10, they're going to want to get up and move, okay? It motivates you, right? But thinking about that movie, how many people remember what happens in Rocky 3? And for you that don't remember, Rocky 3 is, well, Rocky is pretty much, he's won the title. He's won a bunch of fights with the title, all right? And what happens to him? He starts getting a little laid back, doesn't he? He starts not training as hard. He starts realizing he thinks he's untouchable, and he doesn't take his next contender seriously. Does anybody remember who his next contender was? Clubber Lang. Clubber Lang, that's right. A.K.A. Mr. T. And may I add, Mr. T at his Mr. T-iest, right? And kids, if you don't know who Mr. T is, talk to your parents, okay? What happens is he loses the fight, doesn't he? He doesn't just lose. He gets beat horribly, almost ending his career, right? See, God doesn't want us to be content because that's when we lose focus and that's when we get beat up. That's when we get beat up and that when we lose our focus. God wants us to run the race marked out for us. God wants us to work hard to win. He wants us to run with passion because the prize that we're going to get is a good one, better than any title belt. And let's read in verse 25 of what it says, what we win. In verse 25 it says, everyone who competes in the games go into strict training, and they do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. So this race that he's talking about, that he alludes to, people would train and train and train to win this race. And if they were the winner, what did they get? Does anybody know? A crown or a wreath made out of pine needles. All right? So they would run to win this thing that would eventually just fall apart in their hands, right? So that makes me want to ask you this question. what are you running for? What are you doing? Why are you running the race? Are you running the race to make more money? Are you running the race to get a nicer car or a nicer house? Or maybe you're running the race to be more popular. You're running the race to get a boyfriend or a girlfriend or even a spouse. Paul says here that if you're running for any earthly reason or earthly thing, it will tarnish. It is temporary. You can't take it with you. All right? And I know I've said it before, but and I'll say it again, the only thing that we can take with us is people, right? And that is the crown that will last forever. Having eternity with our true God, in the presence of God, with those around us, those who believe in Christ with us. Amen. That is the crown that lasts forever. See, if we live the way Paul did, we become focused on winning people to Christ. We become focused, so focused that we're willing to put other things aside. We're willing to put less important things aside so we can focus on what's important. Keeping that in mind, let's read verse 26. It says, "Therefore, I do not run like someone aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer beating the air. No, I strike a blow to my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize." He says, run with focus, run with discipline, run with all the energy that you have so that you don't disqualify yourself. See, we see Paul has a holy fear and not a fake confidence. And he gives us great advice here. He says, make sure that the power that you have comes from God. When you choose not to tap into Him, you start thinking that you're winning the race and not God. When you choose to try to do it on your own, you have a very good chance of starting to slip away and fall into a place where God is not. And when we slip into a place where God is not, is that a dangerous place? It's a very dangerous place. See, Paul's story was a story that people wanted to read. Still today, we read his story because it's a good one, right? So, what kind of story will people want to read your story, I guess is what I'm saying. Are you writing a story for yourself that once you're gone, once you're no longer part of this world, people are going to want to read? You know, there's a book that came out not too long ago called Kisses from Katie. Has anybody heard of it? All right, some people are nodding. So pretty much what it is this high school prom queen decides to go on a mission trip like a lot of teenagers do, and she fell in love with the area. And she went back and went back, and the last time she went back, she didn't go as a missionary. She went back to live there. And she adopted several young ladies at like 23 years old. And she started doing other programs, and now what she does is she feeds hundreds of kids a day. She has a program where they can go to school. There's programs where women are getting taught how to go out and get a job or make a business themselves. She is doing so much, and she is writing a story for herself. What? That people want to read. People are reading her story. So the question is when you are gone, will people want to read your story? In the video, it's telling us, it says, every day we have a decision as to what plan we want to do. How do we want to travel? Are we willing to take up the path that will be harder at times, but will be a path that will help us, force us to grow, to make us grow, to experience life in a way that only God could provide? That is the question that we need to ask ourselves, and that's what we need to do, and we need to challenge ourselves to do. Now, what I just said, that's just a taste of what your kids are going to learn this summer. Just a taste of what they're going to learn this summer. They're going to be challenged to do more. I want them to be challenged like I hope you're challenged today. To run a race with passion and with heart. All right? Letting this lost and hurting world know about the Christ that you know and you serve. Are you willing to run like you want the prize? Are you willing to run and not let anyone else stop you and never let that passion fade? Knowing that the prize that God has waiting for you is so much more than anything that you'll get on this earth. It's worth it. Let's pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, I just want to thank you and praise you for who you are. Lord, I thank you for the words that you have given us, that through these years we can still, all these years, we can still look back and we can apply it to our lives. Lord, thank you for making everything so relevant for us to be still be able to understand today, Lord. I thank you for your Holy Spirit that you allow to move in this place and allow us to get a deeper understanding of you and to grow closer to you, Lord. We thank you for that. Lord, I thank you for this church that sacrificially gives in so many ways of money and time and just so that, and people, so that Wolverine can be what it is today, Lord. And Lord, I just pray right now for Wolverine Christian Service Camp. Lord, I pray for the children that will be coming this summer, Lord. Lord, I pray right now that you will just tear down any strongholds that might be hindering them from growing closer to you, Lord. Lord, I pray for the parents that are concerned about being able to send their kids to camp or if they should send their kids to camp. Lord, I pray right now that you will put people in their lives to encourage them and to show them just how great Wolverine can be for their children. Lord, I pray for all the faculty that are preparing to come to camp, to those that are giving up weeks of vacation time and time away from their families so that they can invest in the children of Wolverine Christian Service Camp. Lord, I pray for them right now that you will put a hedge of protection around them and that you will allow them to be able to find time and make it a priority to study your word and to study their lessons and when they come to camp that they are ready just to impact lives for eternity. Lord, and I just ask that you will help us to be the servant leaders that you want us to be, Lord. I pray right now that you will help us just to focus more on you, to continue to train in such a way that we can run your race with all the passion and with all the vigor that we have, knowing that what's on the end, the prize that's waiting for us, Lord. Lord, we thank you, we love you, in your precious name. Amen.